light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for our sake became born. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin.
To see Well, good morning, elmesias. As always, it is a blessing to worship with you this morning. Today is the second Sunday of Lent. I pray you are taking this time as an opportunity to grow closer in your relationship with Christ as you meditate upon why it is that he came. This morning, as we lift up our voices in song before God, my prayer is that we would sing with just a little more energy, that we would sing with just a little more gladness as we think about how Christ came, suffered, and died for us. It was out of his great love for us that he did these things, and it is out of our great love for him that we worship this morning. If you haven't done so already, be sure and comment below to let us know that you're here. Also, be sure and share the link and invite a friend. God bless you today. Buenos días, Mesías. Como siempre, es una bendición adorar con ustedes esta mañana. Hoy es el segundo domingo de Cuaresma. Oro que estén aprovechando este momento como una oportunidad para acercarse más en su relación con Cristo mientras meditan sobre por qué Él vino. Esta mañana, mientras alzamos nuestras voces en cánticos ante Dios, mi oración es que cantemos con un poco más de energía y un poco más de alegría mientras pensamos en cómo Cristo vino, sufrió y murió por nosotros. Fue por su gran amor por nosotros que hizo estas cosas y es por nuestro gran amor por Él que adoramos esta mañana. Si aún no lo ha hecho, asegúrese de comentar a continuación para hacernos saber que está aquí. Además, asegúrese de invitar a un amigo. Dios les bendiga. Welcome to worship.
Your grace is enough.
1 Timothy 2 tells us that we are to pray for all people. We are to intercede on their behalf, asking God to help them. We are to give thanks. This morning, church, we have the opportunity to do that as we lift up our petitions and praises before the Lord. If you have any prayer concerns or joys that you'd like to share this morning, I encourage you to share them at this time. We want to pray with you and for you. We also want to rejoice with you in what God is doing in your life. So be sure and post your requests in the comments below. I'm praying God's blessings over you this morning as you lift up your prayers before the Lord.
Tu fidelidad es grande.
Well, as I mentioned earlier, today is the second Sunday of Lent. We are officially into the second week of the season in which the church has historically set aside time in order to self-reflect, in order to mourn over sin, and in order to repent before our holy God in anticipation of Easter. And I mentioned last week that, you know, we should of course be doing these things every day, right? But even so, that doesn't necessarily take away from the fact that there's something special that happens when we do it together as a church. When we together as a church take the time to reflect upon our sins and to turn from them in repentance. You know, when we do that, it brings honor to God and it brings honor to us, His bride, the church. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, it actually reveals to us what happens when the church as a corporate body humbles themselves before God. When we together as a body seek His face and we repent of all the ways in which we failed Him. It says that when we do these things that God hears us from heaven, that He forgives us of our sins, that He promises to restore our land. And I don't know about you, but it sure seems to me that our land needs some restoration. Amen? As a matter of fact, the world does. And so it's always a good thing when we gather together as a corporate body in order to repent of our sins, humble ourselves before God. So it's in that vein that we move forward today. Now, as we reflect upon Christ's journey to the cross, we also reflect upon why He had to go there in the first place. And namely, that's us. You know, He went to the cross because of us, because of our sin. And so what I've decided to do in the remaining weeks leading up to Easter is I'll be breaking down the short definition that I gave you last week with regards to what exactly Lent is. Now, what I told you last week was that Lent is a season of self-examination, it's a season of penitence, and it's a season of self-denial in anticipation of Easter. And so this morning, we are going to be tackling that first part of the definition. Today, we are going to be talking about self-examination. Now, our primary text for today comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 3 to 5, but we'll also be jumping around to various other texts as we discuss this topic this morning. Before we begin, let's go ahead and have a word of prayer. Father, well, God, Lord, as we continue our discussions this morning concerning the topic of Lent, and specifically the topic of self-examination, my prayer is that we'd be brutally honest with ourselves today. I pray that we'd be brutally honest with regards to those areas of our lives that are not of You, those areas of our lives that need to be purged and repented of, those areas of our lives that fall short and are in need of revival. My prayer is that we would be fervent in our desire to become more like You, and that this topic of self-examination would be just the beginning for us as we're spurred on in our desire to love You better through our thoughts and actions. We ask that You would talk to us this morning through Your word. We ask that You would teach us new things. We ask that You would inspire us this morning, both to new heights in our experience of You as well as to new depths of our understanding of Your word. We love You and we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, you know, as I mentioned earlier, the text we're looking at, of course, is 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 3 to 5. I want to give you a quick background on that text as we begin reading. In this passage, what we see is the Apostle Paul is responding to some folks who had questioned his authority. Now, the Corinthian church was a church that was notorious for its immaturity. At this point, the Apostle Paul had already addressed multiple sin issues within their congregation, and now he was writing them concerning his upcoming third visit to come and see them. Now, naturally, folks don't like to be called out in sin, right? I mean, who does? And so they challenged him. They challenged his authority. They thought, you know, what right does he have to call us out? And so now, having been challenged by these folks, the Apostle Paul is responding to them in our text that we're reading this morning. So beginning in verse 3, this is what it says. The Apostle Paul says, I will give you all the proof you want that Christ speaks through me. Christ is not weak when He deals with you. He's powerful among you. Although He was crucified in weakness, He now lives by the power of God. We too are weak, just as Christ was, but when we deal with you, we will be alive with Him and will have God's power. Examine yourselves to see if your faith is genuine. Test yourselves. Surely you know that Jesus Christ is among you. If not, then you fail the test of genuine faith. You know, as I read this passage, a few different things, I guess, stand out to me. The first thing that I notice is that there actually is a test of genuine faith. You know, normally if someone were to tell me to test my faith, I think I might push back a little bit. Because, I mean, the idea that there can be an actual test for someone's faith, it just doesn't seem right, you know? I mean, faith is a personal thing, right? It's abstract. It's different for each person. But in this passage, the Apostle Paul seems to make it really clear to us that, in fact, there is a test when he challenges the people of Corinth. He told them to test themselves. His hope was that they would not fail the test of genuine faith. Now, the Greek word used here in this passage when he tells them to test themselves, it's the word dokimazeta. It comes from the root word dokimazo. And that word, it means to discern, to try, to prove. You know, what the Apostle Paul is telling them here is that they should examine themselves and prove that they are in the faith. He tells them, he challenges them in this manner because he knows that it's a matter of life or death. It's a matter of eternal life or eternal death. In Matthew 7, verses 21 to 23, we read some of the most terrifying words in all of Scripture. In this passage, Jesus tells us here, as he says, "Not everyone who calls out to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who actually do the will of the Father in heaven will enter. On judgment day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, we prophesied in your name. We cast out demons in your name. We performed many miracles in your name. But I will reply, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who break God's laws." Now, I pray no one within the sound of my voice ever hears those words. Now, these are sobering words, and they beg the question, how then can we know? How then can we know that our faith is genuine? Well, you know, as I read the passage this morning, both of these passages, the interesting thing that stood out to me is that within these passages, we have the answer right before our very eyes, if we pay attention. In our Corinthians passage, the Apostle Paul tells them to examine themselves to see if they're in the faith, prove themselves. He goes on to tell them how they could do that. Not only did he reveal that there is, in fact, a genuine test, but in the very same sentence, he told them both the question and the answer to that test. The question and the answer is Jesus. In verse 5, he says, "Examine yourselves to see that your faith is genuine. Test yourselves. Surely you know that Jesus Christ is among you. If not, you failed the test of genuine faith." If Jesus Christ was not among them, they'd failed. Period. In our Matthew text, Jesus said that on judgment day, many would go to him, crying out to him, "Lord, Lord." They would declare to him that they'd prophesied his name. They'd cast out demons in his name. They'd perform many miracles in his name. But his reply to them would be, "I never knew you. Get away from me, you who break God's laws. I never knew you." That's it. What is a test of genuine faith? It's knowing Jesus, period. Now, I have a confession to make this morning. I've been known to get into theological discussions with my pastor friends on occasion, and I've had a few of them tell me that sometimes I tend to oversimplify my faith. They tell me that all I talk about is Jesus and that there's so much more to our faith than simply Jesus. But you know what? I respectfully disagree, because all throughout Scripture we see that Jesus is supreme over everything. Hebrews 12:2 tells us that Jesus is the author and the perfecter of our faith. Colossians 1 verse 15 tells us that Jesus is the visible image of the invisible God. Verse 16 of that same text tells us that through Christ, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things that we can see, the things we can't see. It tells us that everything was created through him and for him. Verse 17 says that he existed before anything else, and he holds all of creation together. Verse 18 says that Jesus is head of the church. He's the beginning, supreme over all, who rise from the dead. Verse 20 says that through him, God reconciled everything to himself, and then he made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of his shed blood on the cross. And that includes us. Verse 21 says that we were once far away from God. We were once his enemies, separated from him through our evil thoughts and desires. Yet now he has reconciled us to himself through the death of Jesus. He's everything. And the Apostle Paul, in an earlier letter of the Corinthians, he told them he'd resolved to know nothing except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Revelation describes him as the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And here in this passage, the Apostle Paul tells us that the test and the answer to our faith, all wrapped in one, is Jesus. This, my friends, is the ultimate test of the genuineness of our faith. It's Jesus. It's not an oversimplification to say that, because the Bible tells us throughout its pages that Jesus is everything. But what does that mean for us in terms of our faith? I mean, if this is a matter of life or death, and it is, then what does that mean? Because we can't afford to not get this right. 2 Corinthians 5:17 tells us this. It says that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone, a new life has begun. Now, the test of genuine faith, the thing we should be examining ourselves over this morning, is whether we have a relationship with Jesus. Okay, so what does that mean? Well, in a nutshell, it means that everything we say and do should be undergirded by our love and our devotion to Him. Do we truly love Him? Is our heart's desire to honor Him in all that we say and all that we do? When we fail Him, which we all do we quickly run back to His loving arms in search of forgiveness with a repentant heart? Or do we run away? Do we wake up thinking about Him? And if we don't, that's fine. You know, some of us are kind of groggy in the morning. We need our coffees, right? But do our thoughts eventually gravitate to Him as we seek to honor Him in our relationships, in our work, in our finances, in our actions, in our everyday lives? Does our relationship with Jesus affect every aspect of our lives? And if it doesn't, then we may want to question whether our faith truly is genuine. Because when we belong to Christ, the Bible tells us that we become new people with new hearts, new motivations, new desires. The old life is gone. The new life has begun. You know, one prominent pastor in one of his sermons said that there are five vital signs of a Christian. And I would like to borrow four of those for the purposes of our test of genuine faith this morning. If any of you are taking notes out there, then you may want to write, and you want to write something down other than just Jesus, then this is probably your opportunity. You know, I think a good test of the genuineness of our faith can be broken down to four different ways that we interact with Jesus in our lives. Four different ways that we demonstrate our relationship with Him. Four different questions that we can ask ourselves as we self-examine to see if our faith is genuine. The first question of self-examination this morning is this: do we love Jesus by keeping His commandments? Do we love Jesus by keeping His commandments? Matthew 22:37 tells us that the most important commandment in all of the law of Moses is to love the Lord our God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. And Jesus is God. If we want a relationship with Him, the first thing we must do is love Him. And how does Jesus Himself say we are to love Him? By keeping His commandments. John chapter 14, verse 15, Jesus says that if we love Him, we are to keep His commandments. It's not a hard question. It's not a hard proposition. It's not complicated. It's not overly burdensome. The question is, are we being obedient? Do we have a desire to be obedient? Are we at least trying? Because a heart that loves Jesus will at least try. It doesn't mean that we're perfect, but it means that we aspire to sin less and less. In Romans chapter 7, verses 15 to 25, we read the words of the Apostle Paul in his struggles with sin. He wasn't perfect. At one point in his letter to Timothy, he called himself the chief of sinners. He says, the worst of all. And yet, his desire was to obey God's word, and in turn, to demonstrate his love for Christ through his obedience. Are we being obedient, or at least do we have an overwhelming desire to be obedient? Do we care? That's the first question of our self-test this morning. The second question on our self-test this morning: do we love others the way that Christ loves them? Do we love others the way that Christ loves them? You know, Matthew chapter 22, verse 39, we learn the second most important commandment is like the first. We're to love our neighbors as ourselves. How are we loving our neighbors? Are we loving them the way that Jesus loves them? By sharing His love with them? by sharing his mercy with them, his grace with them, the same mercy and grace that Christ has shown us in our lives? When someone comes to us with a problem that we don't have, do we immediately judge them for not making better choices in their lives? Or do we love them in the same way that Christ loved them, the woman caught in the act of adultery, by saying, "Your accusers are not here, and neither do I accuse you. Now go and sin no more." And these are some of the ways that we can love others with the love of Jesus in intangible ways. You know, but aside from loving others through intangible ways of showing mercy and grace and compassion, we can also love others in tangible ways. Are we feeding the hungry? Are we clothing the naked? Are we caring for the widow and the orphan? Are we upholding justice for the oppressed among us? You know, recently we all had an opportunity to love our neighbors in tangible ways when many of us lost power, right? You know, were we opening our homes to others? Were we providing shelter for those with no power? Were we providing warm water, warm clothes? You know, these are all ways that we can love others the way that Christ loves them. Are we doing it? Now, this is another question we can ask ourselves in our self-test this morning, you know? And again, these things are not the litmus test of our salvation. They're simply examples to strive for. You know, I don't want anyone to be discouraged if you haven't done these things. I simply want to ask ourselves the hard questions, because sometimes loving God and loving others involves sacrifice. In fact, it often involves sacrifice. So are we doing these things? The third question on our self-test this morning is, do we worship Christ? Do we worship Christ? John 4, verses 23 to 24 says this. It says, "But the time is coming, indeed it's here now, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship in that way, for God is spirit, so those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth." Are we worshiping God? Are we worshiping God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Now, the word worship, it actually comes from an old English term, worth-ship. And what it means when we worship is that we are ascribing worth to that object of our adoration. It means that we are saying that this thing we are worshiping is worthy. And when we worship God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, it means that we are saying that they are worthy of our affections, they're worthy of our sacrifices, they're worthy of our praise. Now, the Father is worthy to be worshiped because, well, the Bible tells us so, right? It tells us in several places that he is to be worshiped, that he is worthy to be worshiped. The text I just quoted a moment ago said that. The Ten Commandments tell us that we should have no other gods before him. You know, we also see it in Revelation chapter 4 when the angels are gathered around the one who's seated on the throne, declaring, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, the one who always was, who is, and still is to come." The Son, Jesus Christ, is worthy to be worshiped because we also see it in Scripture. We see Christ worshiped as an infant when the Magi gathered around him and worshiped. We see him worshiped in his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, which we'll be celebrating in a few weeks. When the crowds declare, "Hosanna, blessed be the one who comes in the name of the Lord." We see in Matthew 14, 33, when Jesus came to the disciples walking on water and they were astonished. The Bible tells us that those in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly you are the Son of God." We see the worship of Jesus in post-resurrection appearances. We see it in a bunch of different places. You know what? The Holy Spirit is also worthy to be worshiped and praised simply because he is God. He is the third person of the Godhead. Psalm 18:3 says, "The Lord is worthy to be praised," and the Holy Spirit is part of that. You know, we don't see explicit examples of worship of the Spirit in Scripture, but we do see the undeniable fact that the Holy Spirit is a person. He is God. And as such, he is worthy of our full worship. Now, how does that translate to us? How do we worship the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? You know, it's not just about singing. It's not just about raising our hands for those of us who do that. It's not just about bowing down or lying prostrate on the floor, though all of those are great means of expressing our worship. I'm an expressive worshiper. I love those things. It's also about how we live in those moments when the music isn't playing. It's about how we live when we're not in church, when we're just out trying to live our lives and temptation comes. It's worshiping God in spirit and in truth. It's living our lives the way the Apostle Paul urges us to live our lives in Romans chapter 12, when he tells us to present our bodies before God as a living sacrifice, the kind that he finds acceptable. The English Standard Version of the Bible tells us that this self-sacrificial worship is actually our spiritual worship. When we present ourselves as living sacrifices, that is spiritual worship. Are we doing that? Are we worshiping God in all these ways? This is the third question on our self-test today. The fourth question on our self-test this morning to examine whether or not our faith is genuine. Do we point others to Christ through our testimonies? Do we point others to Christ through our testimonies? Has Christ changed us so much that people see the difference? Have our lives changed so much that we can declare to those around us, either in word or in deed, that I once was lost, but now I'm found? Does our current life look so different that people who used to know us way back when are like, wow, you've changed? Jesus tells us in Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 and 14, that we are the salt of the earth. We are the light of the world. You know, just as salt preserves a meat that is decaying, we preserve a decaying world. You know, just as light pierces through darkness and enables us to see, we pierce through the darkness of this world and help others to see through our testimonies. We are supposed to be pointing people to Jesus through our changed lives. Are we? That's the fourth question on our self-test this morning. You know, in our text for today, the Apostle Paul admonishes us to examine ourselves to see if our faith is genuine. Test ourselves, he said. Surely we will know that Jesus Christ is among us. And if not, we will have failed the test. You know, there are many questions we could probably ask ourselves to test the genuineness of our faith, really. You know, these are just a few examples. But the real question with regards to whether or not Jesus is present among us, I think, does our love for Jesus translate into action? Does our love for him move beyond our lips? You know, in James chapter 2, verse 17, the writer tells us that faith without works is dead. In verse 18, it says that if someone claims that some have faith while others have works, you are to tell them, you show me your faith apart from your works, and I will show you my faith through my works. Our actions don't save us, but they do demonstrate that we're saved. Now, whether those actions involve God, loving God through our obedience, loving others through our Christ-motivated love for them, whether it involves worshiping God by presenting our bodies as a living sacrifice, or whether it involves demonstrating to others a changed life, in whatever way it works itself out, we pass the test when Jesus Christ dwells among us and his presence is demonstrated through change in our lives. And this morning, as we reflect upon all these different ways in which we can examine ourselves to see if our faith is genuine, my prayer is that we would not be discouraged, but we would be encouraged, because none of us meet the mark. None of us. We all fall short. I'm quite certain that there's no one listening to this message this morning, including myself, that can say with 100% certainty that they passed this test with flying colors. So if you're out there and you're feeling a little discouraged, don't, because we're all in the same boat. What I want for you this morning is to be encouraged, because what I am certain of this morning is that God's grace is free and available to all who respond to his call. Now, there's no one out there who's strayed so far that his arms won't reach. There's no one out there whose sins are so great that Christ's shed blood on the cross can't cover them. Christ is not frustrated with you. Christ loves you. And he demonstrated that love for you by dying for you on the cross. If you're feeling distant from him this morning, believe me when I tell you that he wants you to come back to him. He wants you to receive his peace and to rest in his loving arms of forgiveness and grace this morning. Please join me as we pray. Well, Father, this morning as I pray, I can't help, I can't help but to think of the words of the song, This is Amazing Grace, a popular song that's on the radio nowadays. The words of that song, if I remember correctly, they say, who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all things, or the King above all kings, I should say. It says, this is amazing love, this is amazing grace, this is amazing love, that you would take my place and bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all you've done for me. And as I speak the words of this song, my heart overflows with joy, knowing that no matter how far we've fallen, no matter how far we've strayed, no matter how far we fall short of the perfect standard you've set for us, regardless of all that, Lord, your blood makes up the difference and makes us perfect in your sight. Praise God. I praise you this morning for your unfailing love. God, this morning I pray that you would bless your people as we continue on in this season of Lent. I pray that you would bless us as we seek to purge ourselves of all that is not of you, that you would stir up the spirit that's within us, that you would lead us to your word, that we would be strengthened by it day by day by day. Bless us as we seek to be more and more like you with every passing moment. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, now is a time when we continue our worship through our giving. This is another area in which we can examine ourselves to test the authenticity of our faith. It's through our offering. 2 Corinthians 9:7 tells us that we are not to give reluctantly or under compulsion, but instead we should give according to what we have decided in our hearts, because God loves a cheerful giver. This morning as we give, may we give with cheerful hearts, and may it be our act of worship to the one who dwells among us as our God and King. Please join me in prayer as I bless the offering this morning. Well, Father, we thank you for providing for us today. We thank you for always providing for us with exactly what we need. This morning as we give, we ask that you would bless our offerings, that they would be set apart for your use in the work of your ministry. We're thankful for the blessing of being able to walk in faith and trust you this morning as we give back a portion of what you've given us. May the offerings be used in ways that bless our church and our community. May they bring glory and honor to your name. We pray these things all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh,
2 Corinthians 5:17 says that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone, a new life has begun. As you go out this week, may you walk in the fullness of your identity in Christ. May your light shine in your workplaces, your homes, and your communities, as the joy of Christ's presence with you overflows into every aspect of your life. God bless you. I pray you walk in the richness of your faith as you experience this second week of Lent. 2 Corintios 5:17 dice, de modo que si alguno está en Cristo, ya es una nueva creación. Atrás ha quedado lo viejo, ahora ya todo es nuevo. Esta semana al salir, que caminen en la plenitud de tu identidad en Cristo, que sus luces brillen en sus lugares de trabajo, sus hogares y sus comunidades, mientras el gozo de la presencia de Cristo con ustedes se desborda en todos los aspectos de tu vida. Dios los bendiga. Oro para que caminen en la riqueza de su fe mientras experimentan esta segunda semana completa de Cuaresma. Thank you.